Happy Memorial Day weekend. Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Okay, good. This is the unofficial start of summer. And, you know, I'm originally from Maryland. And one thing that we like to do is celebrate this weekend because it's usually a longer weekend. So today we're going to be making some raw vegan un-crabby cakes. Everybody ready to have some fun? Okay, we're going to start with some almonds, a half a cup of these raw almonds. These are not roasted, not salted. And we're going to process them in the food processor using the S blade, like this. So a half a cup of almonds into the food processor. And we're going to start to make the meal. And I'm going to make some noise. So we're going to process this until it's a really fine powder. So we want it to be dry at this stage. So if you're soaking your almonds, then you want to dehydrate them before you get to this step so that they will not clump together, but they'll actually make into a powder. The idea is here, we want to recreate the texture of the bread that they normally add into crab cakes, to our uncrabby cakes. So I'm going to make some noise again. Okay, and now our almonds are a nice fine powder, which hopefully you can see on the screen here. That's exactly the consistency that we want. And then I'm going to add my almond meal to a mixing bowl here. And the next step is we're going to shred some carrots. So for shredding, I'm going to replace the S blade that was in the food processor with the shredding blade. And so this goes in its place like that. And then we're going to need about a half a cup of shredded carrots. So that's about one medium carrot, about this size. Okay. So let's see what we have here. There we go. So about a half a cup of the shredded carrots we're going to add to the mixing bowl along with the almond meal. This is out of here. Okay, and then for the next step, we're going to mince some celery. So for mincing the celery, I like to slice it along the lifeline, this way, long ways first. And we need about a half a cup. Not necessarily minced, but I would say chopped fine. So this will take probably about 1.5 stalks of celery, depending upon the size of the celery that you have. So we're not only adding a different taste and a different texture, but a different color to our uncrabby cakes. You know, first we have the almond meal, and then we have the shredded carrots, which are orange, and then we're going to add the finely chopped celery, which is the green. Okay. And I'm going to add this to the mixing bowl here. That was a fairly large stalk of celery, so looks like that one stalk of celery makes exactly the right amount, a half a cup. Okay, and then we're going to put in a quarter of a red bell pepper. So now we're adding yet another texture, another flavor, and another color. So, you know, we not only eat with our taste buds, but we also eat with our eyes, and we also eat with our nose. We smell it before we actually bite into it. And we also eat with our touch. So the feel of the food in our mouth as we're chewing it also makes a difference. The hydration level, the freshness, the crispiness, and so on. So that's about a quarter of a red bell pepper. And I'm going to chop this into small chunks, similar in size to the celery chunks, a little bit less than the size of a pea, perhaps 1/4 the size of a pea. Okay, the mixing bowl. How's everybody doing? Are we keeping up? How's my speed? Can you hear me?
We can go a little bit slower. I'm still chopping my celery.
Good, okay. So what we have here so far in the mixing bowl is we have our almond meal, and we have our shredded carrots, and we have our chopped celery. The celery is chopped very fine. And then we have the red bell pepper in the mixing bowl. And then the next thing we're going to add is we're going to add coconut meat. Now for this recipe, you want to get a young green coconut. So the brown coconuts that you see in many stores is a mature coconut. And that coconut meat on the inside is going to be very thick, and it's going to be harder, and it's going to be drier. So that kind of has not the right consistency. So here in South Florida, we're fortunate enough to be surrounded by lots of these young green coconuts. And if you don't happen to live in South Florida, my question to you would be, why not? No, seriously, as a substitute, you could actually use palm hearts. That has the right consistency and the right texture and flavor for this recipe. So first thing we're going to do is we're going to drain the coconut water out of this coconut. And I'm going to use my stainless steel Brazilian coconut opener for that step. So to use this tool, which is a very clever tool, first thing we want to do is we want to pop off the top. And then you turn the coconut right side up. This is the part where the stem is connecting the coconut to the tree itself. And then you insert this tool right around the rim of that stem, tap it down gently, and then you turn it 360 degrees. And as you're turning, you lift up and out pops the cork. And then you can grab one of these mason jars. And we're just going to pour the coconut water into the mason jar like that. And now you have some really, really delicious, very hydrating coconut water. Delicious. Now, the next step is we need to open the coconut up in order to get the meat out. And for that step, I'm going to need to put on my pirate scarf there like that. Okay. And now, if you have any children in the room, you may want to ask them to leave. Okay. So.
Wow.
There we go. So now we have our coconut meat, which I like to use this, my Vitamix spatula for getting the coconut meat out. This makes it very easy to scoop the coconut meat out like that. You can also use a spoon. I actually went to see a Vitamix roadshow about 16 years ago. This is before it was relatively easy to find Vitamixes in the store. So they used to have these roadshows. And when I went to the roadshow, I was very impressed. I bought my Vitamix, my first Vitamix there. And he gave me one of these Vitamix spatulas, which is very nice. Okay, so now what we're going to do is we're going to chop our coconut meat.
Brian, I have a question for you.
Yeah.
So I see you use in Florida coconut, right?
Yes.
Could you explain the difference between different type of coconuts that you can get in stores?
Oh, okay. So we have what we call green coconuts, green Florida coconuts, which looks like one of these. And the husk is still intact on the coconut. And then on the inside of the husk is the shell of the coconut. And that's the hard part. The husk is relatively soft, but it's very fibrous. And that protects the shell itself. When you see the mature coconuts in the store, which are brown, they've already removed the husk from the coconut itself. So all you're really seeing is the inner shell. And those mature coconuts, the inner shell gets very, very thick and gets very hard. The meat on the inside also gets thicker and drier. And the water content goes down on the mature coconut. So a mature coconut is going to have a lot of meat, but very little coconut water. The young coconuts, the young green Florida coconuts, are going to have a lot of water, hopefully all the way full at the top on the inside, but very, very little meat, not much meat at all. And then you have the young Thai coconuts, which have actually had the husk partially shaved off. So they shave the green part off and they shape it and then they dip it in a preservative and then they ship it from Southeast Asia to various parts of the world, including the United States. I like the young Florida coconuts because they haven't used any kind of preservative on the outside. Okay, so we're going to add 1 cup of this coconut meat to our mixing bowl here.
Brian, I have another question for you.
Yeah.
What will be the substitute for coconuts? Sometimes, you know, I don't like the aftertaste in coconut in dehydrated foods.
Yes.
What could be the substitute?
So the substitute for this recipe would be palm hearts. That has exactly the right consistency and the right moisture level and the right kind of flavor. Now, if it can be hard to find raw palm hearts as well. So the palm heart is actually the very, very young, tender new growth inside a palm tree. And that's kind of like the filet mignon of young palm trees. Typically, when you find palm hearts in the store, they're usually in a jar or in a can or something like that. In that case, they're no longer raw. They've been cooked. They've been pasteurized in order to kill the enzymes to give it shelf life. In some rare cases, you can find some truly raw, uncooked palm hearts. Now, if you don't want to use coconuts and you can't find raw palm hearts, white mushrooms will also work for this recipe. It's a little bit different kind of consistency, a little bit different flavor, but that's okay. It'll still work. What I like about the coconut meat, the young Florida green coconuts, is that the right moisture.
Look.
Okay, so I'm going to add.
Rock, paper, scissors, shoot. Ah! I knew you were going to do that.
So far is we have our almond meal. And we have our chopped red bell pepper, chopped celery, our shredded carrots, and our coconut meat. Now, the next step is we're going to add some chopped green onions, about a fourth of a cup. Now I'm using these flat scallions. That also works just simply because I happen to have these growing in the garden outside. So I just went out and grabbed some, but regular green onions will also work. And we want to chop these fine. They don't really have to be minced. And we want about a quarter of a cup. And then I'm going to add a little bit of chopped parsley as well. About a half a cup of chopped parsley. So we're going to chop this fine. There we go. I just love the smell of fresh herbs, including parsley. I'm going to chop this up a little bit better. Okay. And that should give us about a half a cup. Chopped parsley, there we go. I'm going to add that into the mixing bowl. Okay, and then we're going to add 1 tablespoon of kelp granules. So this is going to give it that sort of ocean taste to our uncrabby cakes. Also a good source of iodine and other rare trace minerals. And then 1/4 teaspoon of cayenne to give it a little bit of a kick. Actually, let me take that back. 1/8 teaspoon of cayenne. 1/4 would probably be too much, unless you really like it hot and spicy. Okay, and then we're going to add 1 teaspoon of smoked paprika. This is going to give it that Old Bay taste. I have enough. Uncrabby cakes. And then we're going to add 2 tablespoons of lemon juice, fresh pressed lemon juice. So an average size lemon, if you juice the whole thing, is going to give you about 2 tablespoons. If you cut it in half, that's going to be about 1 tablespoon of lemon juice. So I'm using my lemon press here to squeeze the lemon juice out. The other thing I like about this lemon press is that it captures the seeds, so the seeds don't wind up in your recipe. Which sometimes can, it's not going to ruin the recipe, but it kind of spoils the taste, you know, once you bite into a lemon. Okay, what else? So now we need to add some ground flax seeds. So whenever you're buying flax seeds, you should also make sure that they are whole rather than pre-ground for you. I prefer to grind them myself. Because flaxseed powder will oxidize very, very quickly. So we want to add it, we want to grind it ourselves and then add it to our recipe rather than buying it already pre-ground. And we need, how many flaxseeds here? We need 1/4 cup of flaxseeds. So what I'm using here to grind my flaxseeds is simply a spice mill. Also commonly used as a coffee grinder. This one is made by Regal. coffee and spice mill. So you simply attach the cap. Ground flax seeds to the bowl. Last ingredient is we're going to add some celery juice. So I'm going to take my celery over here to my juicer, and we need a half a cup of celery juice. So let me grab the container. I'm using my Omega 8006 for this juicing. It's a slow turning auger style juicer, so it preserves more of the nutrients in your juice rather than a high speed juicer. So to make a quarter of a cup of celery juice, you need about a half of a bunch of celery like that. And let's see how we're doing here. And now I'm going to use my liquid measuring cup. So a half a cup or a cup of dry measure is not the same as a half a cup or a cup of liquid measure. It's very close, but it's not exactly the same. So we want to make sure that we're using a liquid measure for this. So that's a half a cup of celery juice. Now the purpose of the celery juice in this recipe is to add has a salty taste, but without the sodium chloride. So what we have in here is we have our almond meal in the mixing bowl. And then we have our coconut meat, our shredded carrots, our finely chopped celery, red bell pepper, our green onion, parsley. And we have kelp granules, lemon juice, cayenne, smoked paprika, and ground flax seeds, along with our celery juice. And now I'm just going to, using a mixing spoon, I'm going to combine everything. So mix it all together well.
What about mustard powder?
Oh, I decided not to put the mustard powder in. It doesn't really need it. So I sometimes I'll add mustard powder, but I like it simple. So I kind of deleted that from the recipe. Sometimes if you add too much, then it can get a little complicated. I like to be able to taste the vegetables and the fresh herbs that are in here.
And no garlic powder, right?
No garlic this time, yeah. I deleted the mustard powder and the garlic. You can add that as an option if you wanted to, but I don't think it really needs it. You know, I'm constantly refining my recipes and making them better. Now, the other thing about the flax seeds is they act as the binder. So when the flax seeds combine with the moisture in the freshly chopped vegetables and the coconut meat and in the celery juice, then they will begin to get sticky and it will make a paste that will kind of hold everything together when we're making our un-crabby cakes. There's also some good omega-3s and lignans in flax, which is very good for our cardiovascular system and so on. Okay, so now everything is combined like this.
Hey, Brian.
Yeah.
Yeah, Is there a replacement you could use for flax seeds?
Well, not really. I mean, if you left the flax seeds out, you could still make this recipe. It's not really so much in there for the flavor as it is for the consistency of the uncrabby cakes. If you left the flax seeds out, you could still make uncrabby cakes, but they would be a little bit crumbly. You know, they would not hold together quite as authentically as uncrabby should.
Gotcha. Thank you.
It looks so good, Brian, and smells so good. Wow. Ah.
So the next step is we need to make our burgers, our uncrabby cakes, and put them on the dehydrator tray. So this is a perfect opportunity to use that cool burger press that Dr. Graham introduced us to in a previous show. If you missed that, then you can always subscribe to our subscription plan and view previous shows. But that is a really, really super cool tool for making raw vegan burgers, veggie burgers, and uncrabby cakes. Now, if you don't happen to have one of those really cool burger presses, you can improvise. All you really need is a mason jar like this. There's something about the raw vegan lifestyle that we love mason jars. I'm not sure exactly what that is. I guess because it's made of glass and it's versatile. So you simply take the lid off the mason jar, and we're going to use that as our burger press. So you take a scoop of our mixture here and just add it to your mason jar lid. This is a 1-quart wide mouth mason jar. And kind of smooth it off like this. And then you turn it upside down onto your dehydrator tray, and then just remove the lid. And you have a nice, beautiful uncrabby cake on your dehydrator tray. So this recipe will make about 6 of these uncrabby cakes. So just keep shaping them in your mason jar lid or in your burger press. If anybody happens to know the name of that burger press that Dr. Graham introduced us to, then perhaps they can post it in the comments. How's my speed? Am I going fast enough? Too fast?
You're perfect. Perfect.
Good.
Good timing, yes.
You're getting a lot of good comments here, Brian.
Oh, good. Thank you so much.
Well, it's because how he looks in his pirate costume.
Well, you know, I've got a couple of different cutting boards here. You know, I've got my regular bamboo cutting board for my pedestrian kind of recipes. And then I have my big coconut cutting board back here for splitting coconuts open. I normally do that outside, but I brought it in the kitchen for the show rather than that way. I don't have to worry about moving the camera around. It works almost as well as that cool burger press. I absolutely love this recipe. It's very reminiscent of, you know, what I grew up with. And this is the perfect recipe. This is the perfect day for the day before Memorial Day. This is something you can introduce to your friends and your family who aren't necessarily on this stage of their journey, and they will love it. Okay, so we're gonna pop these in the dehydrator. And And I'm using the Excalibur Fortrait dehydrator today. I really like Excalibur dehydrators. I've had, and I've used the 8 tray, I've used the 6 tray. I also had a 12 tray Cabela's dehydrator, which is a really nice commercial dehydrator, but it's big and it's loud. What I like about this Fortrait Excalibur dehydrator is it's relatively small in size. And so it makes it easy when I'm traveling, if I'm, you know, going to be doing recipes on the road, which I will frequently do. If I'm entertaining, if I'm camping, if I'm traveling. And we're going to go ahead and crank that up. I'm going to crank it all the way up for the first 20 minutes and then back off to about 135 for the next 20 minutes. And then I'm going to back it down to about 115. And we need to dehydrate for about 3 hours for this particular recipe. You don't really want to over dehydrate this recipe because the coconut meat will get kind of rubbery, kind of chewy. So we want it to be, we just want to create sort of a crust on the outside. So 3 hours at 115 is the perfect amount of time. Now, while we're waiting for that to finish dehydrating, we can actually start to make the dill tartar sauce. Which is going to be the garnish on top of our uncrabby cakes. So for the dill tartar sauce, we're actually going to be using the Vitamix.
Hey, Brian?
Yeah.
Yeah, what was the initial temperature for the dehydrator?
Oh, the initial temperature, I turned it all the way up on this Excalibur dehydrator. That means 155, just for the first 20 minutes.
So, 20 minutes, first 20 minutes.
Yeah, just for the first 20 minutes. And then I back it off to about 135 for the next 20 minutes, back it off to 115 for the remainder of the hours. So food that you put in the dehydrator, like the uncrabby cake, is moist, has a lot high water content. And as you're dehydrating initially in the beginning, some of that moisture on the outside of the uncrabby cakes will begin to evaporate. And that is sort of exactly what happens to us when we perspire. As we sweat, then we have moisture evaporating from our skin, and that cools us down. And that also cools down the food that you have in the dehydrator until that moisture is gone, which takes maybe 20 minutes or so. And then it starts to warm up. So we want to evaporate the moisture outside relatively quickly, and then we want to get a nice sort of
Brian, we cannot hear you. Brian, we lost your sound.
There.
Okay.
It's coming in.
Okay, great. Oops.
Brian?
There we go. Can you hear me now?
Yes, perfect. Thank you.
Sorry about that. Lost connection there temporarily. Technical difficulties. This is the one of the exciting things about doing a live show is you never know what to
online.
Expect.
Right.
Okay. So let's make our dill tartar sauce. So for the dill tartar sauce, we're going to use 1 cup of pine nuts. Now, I have doubled the recipe for the dill tartar sauce compared to what we originally published, simply because on some types of blenders, you need enough sufficient volume in the pitcher itself to actually make it into a cream. So 1 cup of raw pine nuts, and then we're going to add 1 cup of raw cashews. Okay, and then we're going to add, basically we're gonna add some more celery juice here. Now, what did I do? Oh, here it is, okay. So we're gonna need about a half a cup or more of this celery juice. We need to add enough moisture or liquid here to make it creamy.
Brian, what's your recommendations for nut substitute, like pine nuts and cashews?
Well, you could use coconut meat once again for this recipe instead of nuts, and that's going to be easier to digest, and it really doesn't take away anything from the flavor, so that works perfectly fine as well. And then we're going to need some mustard powder. Let's see if I can find my mustard powder.
Will zucchini work?
A zucchini will work too, yeah. That's going to not give it the same flavor as, you know, we really are accustomed to when we come to a tartar sauce, but it's going to be much easier to digest with zucchini. Okay, so I'm going to add my mustard seed, 1 teaspoon of mustard seed powder. Notice that we're not actually using the liquid mustard because the liquid mustard has vinegar in it, which is acetic acid, which is something we want to try to avoid. Okay, and then we're going to add some lemon juice. So I'm going to use another whole lemon here. These are relatively large, so I'm just kind of trimming the ends off here a little bit. Get out my lemon press again. So 2 tablespoons of lemon juice. So that's a whole lemon. I'll give you about 2 tablespoons.
Hey Brian.
Yeah.
For the cashews, did you soak them before putting it?
Yes. So for the dill tartar sauce, you can soak the cashews, soak the pine nuts ahead of time. You know, because that's going to work perfectly. So what I have under here is I have 1 cup of pine nuts soaked, and then 1 cup of cashews soaked, and I have basically 1/2 cup of celery juice and 2 tablespoons of lemon juice. And we're gonna blend now. We're not going to add the dill and the shallots just yet, or the green onions, because we wanna make the cream first. So I'm going to transfer this over here to Vitamix and make some noise. So this is the new Vitamix, and one of the features that it has is it has a soft start, so it doesn't go to full speed right away. It also has the feature that it will automatically blend for a specific period of time that you set it for. So in this case, it blended for 50 seconds, just under a minute, and then it automatically stops, which is, as it turns out, just the right amount of time to make a nice cream sauce here. So I'm going to grab another mixing bowl here, I think.
Brian, you can use hemp seeds as well, right?
Oh yeah, you could use hemp seeds as well. So anytime you're using seeds, I think you're better off in terms of if digestion is a question than nuts. Nuts are typically heavier than seeds.
And why vinegar is not good? I saw some question there.
So the issue with vinegar is that it is acetic acid, and acetic acid, you know, vinegar is just diluted acetic acid, and acetic acid is actually a poison. If you go into any chemistry lab anywhere in any school or any science lab anywhere in the world, you'll see a bottle of acetic acid on the shelf, only it has a skull and crossbones on it. Not too different from the skull and crossbones on my hat here. So it's not really, vinegar, as it turns out, is not really healthy for us to ingest in our recipes. So I just use mustard powder instead of the actual mustard itself. Now we're going to add 2 tablespoons of finely chopped shallots, or you can use these, once again, you can use green onions that have been finely chopped. By the way, so you can see what I'm doing here. Okay, I think that's going to give us about 2 tablespoons. And we're going to add that to our dill tartar sauce. How are we doing on time, Joseph?
We have about 15 minutes.
Yeah, 15 minutes.
Oh, okay, good. All right, then we're going to add some fresh chopped dill. So we need about 1/4 cup of fresh dill. We want to chop this fine. And I just love the smell of fresh herbs. Okay, that'll give us about 1/4 cup. I keep my herbs in the refrigerator flat like this with water in them. They're kind of like bouquets of flowers. And they last longer that way, they stay fresh. We're just going to combine using a mixing spoon here. So what we have in here is we have our tartar sauce or cream, which is made of nuts. And we also have some lemon juice, celery juice in there. We added a teaspoon of mustard powder and fresh shallot, green bell pepper, or sorry, green peppers, and dill. Then just combine it like this. And then we're going to scoop this up into a serving bowl here. Okay. And now we're ready to serve our uncrabby pigs. So what I did is I made some uncrabby pigs ahead of time and started them in the dehydrator so that they would be ready in time for today's show. So I started these about 3 hours ago, and now they have the perfect consistency that we want for our uncrabby cakes. They're just a little bit of a crust on the outside of the uncrabby cake. So I'm going to start my plating.
Hey, Brian, get two plates. I'm coming over.
Come on over.
Coming over, I'm flying.
Food here. So I'm gonna actually take a leaf of lettuce like this. Oh, that's a big leaf. We could probably get away with cutting that in half like that. And then I'm going to take one of my uncrabby cakes here and put it on top like that. And then I'm going to find a nice heirloom tomato, and we're going to put a tomato slice on there. Like that. And then we're going to take a little bit of our dill tartar sauce and put a dollop right on top like that. And there we have it.
Wow, yummy. Looks spectacular, Brian, just spectacular.
Bring this a little closer to the camera.
All right.
How's that look?
Looking awesome, just beautiful.